I'm author Mark Muncy.
And I'm author Erica Lance.
And this is Eerie Travels. Greetings, travelers.
Greetings, travelers. I'm in a squeaky chair today, so if anybody hears squeaks, I apologize for that. Recording in a different place.
That's part of the thing. I thought your minions that work in your secret bunker lair would take care of that for yourself. So
you would think so, but you know, it's been hard to find good minions.
Vaporize the minion that's in charge of oiling the chair.
Yeah, well, that minion's a clone of a clone of a clone, so it's not working out well for me.
One of these days, we're going to have to do just like a super villain 101 and like things like that on how to take care of your minions and stuff. We did a thing many, many millions of years ago in the early days of the internets.
I knew you were going to segue into this.
Yeah, I had to segue into this. Sorry, Callie, you were forced to listen to it much.
Every car ride, man.
There was a bunch of the Bureau 13 news group. We were doing a group called Mephisto Media, and we were pretending to be a radio station for supervillains. And one of the things we did was like, your new evil henchman. And it was done like the sound of an old slideshow. Boop, boop, boop. You know, where you're changing the slides. And it was, you know, gone long ago are the days of the dumb henchmen.
Well, people are so excited about our episodes, like the most powerful werewolf and stuff. We got a lot of comments, so we should do one on our favorite, the best and the worst supervillains.
Okay, yeah, that would be good. Yeah,
we'll throw that in there. We'll throw that in there.
We'll do one on mistakes that henchmen make and stuff. So yeah, that'd be good. So
exactly.
But anyway, oh my gosh, it's it's summer. We're moving through things. And the world is going crazy. Have you seen some of the headlines?
I have, which makes me think we need a breaking news.
Oh my gosh. Yes. Yes. I've got one that this one floored me because there's video of this, which is, no, it's not something in the air, but it is something in the air. Ready for this? A woman freaks out. It's a plane, and a woman freaks out on airplane, says she's getting off the plane because the person she was sitting beside is not real. And this is amazing. I mean, airplanes have always been dangerous, but some people just go crazy, right? And this is another one of those ladies, just major disturbance. And it looks like it's about to take off. It's unclear in the video whether it's actually in the air or not, but she was trying to force her way off the craft. And then she's like, the person next to her, not real. It's not real. Wow.
I loved this video. We're going to be sharing it in the notes.
Yeah, I love
this video, but what I didn't feel was touched upon enough by the people taping it. Yeah. Or, oh my God, I just said taping it.
Oh man,
nobody knows what that means. Anyway, by the people with their smart devices, I feel the person that she thought was not real needed a lot more screen time.
Yes, yes, because it's not filmed at all in this.
Yes.
I'm like, all right, so it could be, Matrix.
She could be right. That person could be not real. We'll never know because we don't see them. And for the record, there are some drugs that are bad to take when you're going on a plane. I'm just going to throw that out there. drugs can be bad on a plane. There are certain drugs that I will endorse to be on a plane, but any ones that may or may not cause hallucinations or paranoia, maybe don't take them before you board your aircraft.
Well, Carrie's been watching a lot of House lately, I keep thinking, oh man, maybe she was having some sort of odd symptom. And this is, hiding something. And let's face it, folks, mental health is definitely something that, people need to take care of. And that, not just for the person who is getting kicked off the plane, but also maybe the person who wasn't real next to him.
Yeah, I'm just going to throw this out. I don't feel she was being kicked off the plane. She was trying to leave the plane.
Yeah.
They just were not backing her play. So I get it. It's very interesting. But because I know what we're going to be talking about in this episode.
This is going to tie into this. That's why I brought this story to the forefront.
Well, I also found a story on our friend's Paranormality magazine.
Hey!
If you use the code TRAVELS, you can get 10% off their swag. This article is behind the paywall. So this article is called The Tormented Life of an UFO Experiencer. And it's set in a small Pacific Northwest town. Brian, a man in his mid-40s, led a haunted life by bizarre encounters and unexplained lost time events since childhood. These eerie episodes, shrouded in mystery, plagued Brian and his family, leaving them searching for answers. Despite his attempts to lead a normal life, Brian's struggles persisted, affecting his career, his relationships, and ultimately leading to his untimely demise. So this article delves into the enigmatic world of lost time and abduction experiences, using Brian's story as a lens to explore the hardship faced by those who endure such encounters. I think that is very timely for both this woman on the plane and what we're going to be talking about today.
And we just talked about, we just did the episode on Indrid. And, the Derenbergers had, were multiple time contactees and had to deal with that stuff their whole lives, and how it basically ruined Woody's life and all that. It's pretty crazy out there. So I see why people try to avoid talking about this sometimes. This is why it's tough to get people to come forward and discuss these things. So, yes.
I also think, there's the whole side of people saying they saw a UFO and things like that. And of course, generationally, I think things have changed. But, I think it goes into a whole layer, which we're not going to go into in this episode at all, of not being believed or being heard, by people, because it's very easy to dismiss things. And we constantly say we don't know what things are. And we do our own looking into things. And me and you both have separate beliefs on different situations that, we've talked about on the show and we encounter. But I think there definitely is a whole thing to somebody's experiences and their reality with what they saw, especially in something that's so heavily polarized as UFOs and are UFOs here and stuff like that. I think I could see, especially if you have multiple experiences and things that you can't explain, how it would be very hard. But I think this is true for people who encounter cryptids and people who encounter ghosts and all this kind of thing, is that we're delving into something a very small area of the population is saying that it had an experience with. And so it definitely gets into being the minority and not the majority in social situations. So be nice to those who've seen UFOs. That's all I'm going to say.
And or people that aren't real on the plane. So
yes.
Anyway. We're going to go back. We are, last December was the 50th anniversary of an event. And we marked it by being down in the Everglades for the anniversary of the event. And it was, it's December in Florida. It's the only time to go to the Everglades in Florida because the mosquitoes are all in hell where they belong. And the alligators are all a little sleepy. So, you can go down in the Everglades and not have to deal with quite as much as you do the rest of the year. But I'm going to take us on the way back machine again. We're going to go back to December 29th, 1972.
You know, I love me some time travel.
Yep.
What happened on December 29th?
All right. So Eastern Airlines Flight 401. So some people know this story, some people don't. So buckle up, people. There may be a slight trigger warning for this because it does involve an airline disaster and some deaths, but I'll try to keep the gruesome details minimal. So
let's officially call it a trigger warning. If these are things that are triggers for you. You may choose not to listen to this episode and pick a different one.
Yeah, if airline disasters scare you, this one was probably one of the worst of its day. It was definitely at the time the second worst airline disaster of all time.
Okay.
But, all right. So what happened? Basically the plane left JFK Airport from New York, and it was en route to Miami International Airport. And it had been a long trip for this, right? It had gone up, it had gone down, it had left Miami earlier and was coming back on its return home.
Okay. And,
it's pretty crazy. So,
and many people don't necessarily know this, but most flights do laps to various cities, and even if it's multiple cities, but they usually start off in one city, go to multiple cities, and come back to the origin city. That's been how flights work for some time.
Yeah. So this was Eastern Airlines, and it was a Lockheed L1011-1 TriStar. So for you plane aficionados, and it was a fairly new plane. It was, new, hadn't been used very long. And that was kind of new to Eastern Airlines. They hadn't really used these wide body planes that much, and had 163 passengers and 13 crew members on board. So altogether 176 people on board. And the flight,
I'm just going to point out, that's a lot of people considering they don't have nearly that amount of staff on most large airplanes anymore.
Right. Not anymore, right? Now it's what, five?
Maybe on the big ones. Usually it's back like when, two or three.
You actually got blankets and food, real food on your plane, and you could stretch out a little bit. These were big planes.
You could smoke on the planes. Do you remember
yeah,
that?
Yeah, it was the 70s. So yeah. And basically on approach, the pilot, who's Bob Loft, and he had over three decades of flight experience, and he was coming home, and they had a first officer, Albert Stockstill, and then they had a flight engineer, Donald Repo. Some people said navigator, but navigators were pretty much done by this time. So he was a flight engineer, and then the 10 flight attendants. So that's the crew. And the plane is beginning its descent into Miami. This is late December 29th, right? So it's coming up on New Year's.
And I'm sure it's very snowy weather.
Oh, yeah, in Miami, coming over the Everglades. So probably a nice 80 degrees. Anyway, the plane's beginning its descent. Passengers and crew prepare for landing. And Stockstill, who's first officer there, the co-pilot, notices that the landing gear light indicator has not turned on, and showed that the nose gear down was locked. So they cycled the landing gear several times. Nothing's coming. So they contact the tower in Miami and say, hey, we've got an issue. Something's not right. And the quote was basically, tower, this is Eastern 401. Looks like we're going to have to circle. We don't have a light on our nose gear yet. And so the controllers kind of give their okay and say, all right, just maintain your altitude, 2,000 feet, and circle around over the Everglades and come back. Because that way you're not over the city. We don't want to, we don't want to risk anything. And so the pilots engage autopilot and start trying to figure out what the heck's the problem. And they're like, it might just be the light. It can go bad. This is 1970s. Lights, light bulbs, can go bad. Not LEDs like they are now. So the engineer, Repo, says, I'll go down under and I'll check the indicator through the peephole. And what they actually have under the cockpit is a place called the hell hole. And this guy climbs down in there. And what they've got is this little, it's kind of like a doorbell, looking out your door peephole, and you can look out front and visually confirm that the landing gear is down.
Okay.
This is where all the wiring and everything else is. So he goes down there and starts climbing through. Now, what happened is at some point, while the guy, the captain and the first officer up there are trying to figure out what switch, because, you know, what else they can do, somehow they bump the autopilot switch, we think, and turn it off. So they start losing altitude as they're circling.
Wow. So, wow.
How do, only you, at 2000
how do you mess
feet.
That up?
It's pitch black because it's night. And the crew notices something's wrong. And they get this little notification. The first officer's like, "We must have done something to the altitude." And the captain's replies, "What?" "Yeah." And he's like, "We're still at 2,000 feet, right?" Your first officer asks. And that's where the tape cuts off. Now, we hear the guy, Repo, down in the hellhole. He gets to the front and he looks out and he sees the landing gear is down. So it's fine. It wasn't out light. But then he sees trees. They're supposed to be at 2,000 feet. They were at 200 feet. They were going 227 miles an hour. They crash into the Everglades.
Yeah. So to just set the stage for anybody who might not completely understand the Everglades, that first of all, in Florida, there are no mountains. Mountains do not exist in Florida. No. That is not a thing. So most of Florida is at sea level or a few feet above, but not very high. So when you're saying that you see trees, it's not like you're seeing a mountainous forest, blah, blah, blah. You are literally seeing something that is probably 20 feet tall.
Yeah, 20, like 30 maybe. Feet tall. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe.
This is the Everglades. So there were some bigger trees, but not many. So they scatter wreckage approximately 1,600 feet long and about 300 feet wide. And then a fire starts.
Wow.
Now, there are survivors. Because almost immediately, airboat operators in the area see the flash. Because they're all out frog hunting and doing other things in the Everglades that you do.
Gator hunting,
other things like that. And one of the guys we got to talk to, his guy's named Bud Marquis. And he's like, I was a doctor. I didn't know what to do, but I knew I had to go out there and help people. So he went out with his airboat. And it was basically like the Cajun Mafia that they call it now, that actually go and help people in disasters. This is kind of like an early version of that. People start showing up and the Coast Guard is quickly notified and helicopters immediately start coming. And they're all from their station in Opa-locka, which is, you know, middle of nowhere, Florida. And they had trouble finding the wreckage. But Marquis was actually one of the guys who was signaling the helicopters with his swamp buggy. Looking for help. So it was his light that they were able to home in on, which was pretty darn cool. This man was is a unsung hero that, you know, people disappeared from. And so dozens of people are airlifted to hospitals. And 14 people suffered burns and 17 only had minor injuries, which is pretty crazy.
Well, I mean, in a way, it kind of makes sense. You're pretty close to the ground, you know?
Right, and they were ready for landing. So it was, they were buckled up. And, so it was, the safety measures at the time was pretty good. They held up. And it was the second deadliest plane crash in U.S. history at the time. Now, by today's standards, it's probably around 15th or 16th.
How many people passed away?
93 immediately, and several others later died of their wounds. Now, the pilot died instantly. Stockstill was a little alive, but he died while they were getting him out of the wreckage.
Okay.
The first officer. I'm sorry, I had that backwards. Sorry. Stockstill died immediately and the pilot died as they were pulling him from the wreckage. Now, Repo, down in the hellhole, he makes it to the hospital and dies a couple days later.
Oh, wow.
Now, most of the stewardesses survived. Most of the rest of the crew survived. And that's a, you know, just a crazy deal that, that it, you know, that this many people did that, right? It's, you know, they survived this harrowing ordeal and being dragged out of the swamp. Flames, jet fuel, the Everglades is just, you know, crazy at this point, but it happened. Now, this is where it gets crazy.
Okay, well, then we should take a break real quick.
Yes.
And come back to getting crazy.
Eerie Appalachia. Gear up for a frightful jaunt into the darkest reaches of the ancient Appalachians. Folks deep within the Appalachian hollers, lean close to the campfire to share stories of the inexplicable with hushed awe. Monsters rumbling in the hills, strange lights darting through the pitch black night sky, horrible occurrences almost ineffable in their bizarre tragedy. Tall tales, you might say. Tell that to the Flatwoods Monster in Braxton County, West Virginia, or the Goatman of Louisville. Look into his humanoid eyes and let him know you don't believe. And what of those apparitions in Mammoth Cave's Corpse Rock, or the Satan spawn known as the Jersey Devil? How do you respond when confronted by these mysteries? From the metaphysical energy that swirls near Serpent Mound in Ohio to Point Pleasant's Mothman legacy, Mark Muncy and Carrie Schultz explore the dark history lurking in the shadows of Appalachia. Read by Mark Muncy, author and experts on strange folklore with appearances on shows such as Ancient Aliens, The Curse of Robert the Doll, and many, many more.
Greetings, mortals and others. I'm Dick Terhune, the voice from hell. I work with haunted attractions all over the US, Canada, and Europe to increase audiences and enhance their experience with highly effective commercials, narrations, animatronic character voices, whatever your dark heart desires. Let me help you do more, scare more, profit more. Find out more at Voice from Hell on Facebook and at voicefromhell.com.
Okay, so we're back. Flight 401, 410, 410
yeah.
is in the Everglades.
401.
Okay, sorry. 401 is in the Everglades. It's crashed. We have
19 miles north of Miami International Airport. You know, 75 survivors, basically.
Okay.
And the...
Did they find everyone?
They found pretty much everybody. All the remains are found, and the survivors are found. One of the things Marquis talked about was seeing a head floating in the water. That was, you know, pretty crazy. But the crash, parts of the plane were actually surprisingly in good shape, and a lot of the parts were in really good shape. Like I said, this was a fairly new plane, so Eastern scavenges the parts and decides we're going to use these to repair other L-1011s.
Okay, I need to put a pause here. So from a corporate standpoint, I just want to notify, because I have no idea what Mark's about to say,
yeah,
but let me tell you what a terrible plan this is to reuse parts of something where people died. Like, this is not a good plan. This was not a well thought out plan. Okay, continue.
All right, so this is where our story, why this is such a famous story, right? I mean, the fact it was one of the most dangerous, you know, biggest airline disasters of all time. But what happens is the crew gets spread out to other planes, right? They got to keep their jobs. They got, you know, they're still working.
And we're talking about only the stewardesses, because everybody else doesn't survive.
Everybody else didn't make it, but the stewardesses start going on to other flights.
Okay.
And what they start doing, though, on these other flights is they're seeing things. They're seeing some of the dead crew members on these other flights. They're very unusual sightings. Mostly Robert Loft. And one stewardess had an encounter with, where she swore Don Repo was in his flight engineer outfit fixing an oven in the galley of their ship. And that oven had been taken from the wreckage and put into the new plane.
I absolutely would have quit that minute. Like, no, you're not getting me on another plane after I'm seeing ghosts of the people from that accident. Mm-mm. Bye. Yeah,
no, I concur 1,000% with this. This would be an overall nope for me. So I'm willing to bet they didn't know that those parts were from their old plane, correct?
No, they did not.
Okay.
They did not. And story starts, circulating, right? There's some definitely something going on. And one of the most famous is this one person, he was working on, I'm trying to remember how it goes because it's such a crazy story. He's working on the engine and he's going to do the pre-flight check. And suddenly Repo is there standing next to him, says, "Don't worry, I've already done the pre-flight check. Everything's fine. We are never going to allow another crash on our watch."
Wow.
Then another point, they say this is the captain speaking. "We think there might be a fire." Well, the captain hadn't boarded the plane yet.
And it came over the loudspeakers?
This was over the loudspeaker in the plane. The captain comes on as he hears this. And they go to check where he reported the fire. There's a faulty wire that could have caused a fire.
Wow. Oh, hell nah. Nah.
Yeah.
Nah.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Well,
if you're going to be a ghost, be a guardian ghost. That's exactly my thought.
And now this guy named John Fuller, who's an author, he starts collecting all these stories because these other crew members are coming to him. Now what's happening is also other pilots who knew the dead crew members are coming as well and saying, "Hey, I was on a plane and I turned, and next to me in the co-pilot seat was Stockstill. And he said, and he turned to me, didn't say a thing, just ghostly white, and then vanished." Another first officer goes to check the hellhole because he hears some noises from the hellhole in his plane. And he opens it up and he sees Repo's face looking back up at him. These were guys they'd worked with. So these are guys they knew. And wow. They all log them in the logbooks on the various planes. Now, what happens is Eastern Airlines starts looking at these logbooks going, "We can't be the ghost airline. We can't be the haunted airline." So they switch out. Whenever anybody reports something, they swap out that logbook and pretend the old logbook doesn't exist anymore. They also make a note saying if anybody says they see a ghost on a plane, they have to go see the shrink and they can't work until they're cleared by the psychiatrist.
Wow. I mean, for a company to start taking those kind of actions, it has to be a prevalent situation.
Exactly. Now, they were always on other L-1011s, the sightings. And by the end of 1974, they stop. So a couple years. Pretty prevalent. Now, what happened in that meantime, right? Mostly people stopped reporting it because they don't want
to. Well, it became kind of dangerous to report it. I didn't even know any of this. And my whole entire thing I said at the beginning of this podcast is coming to fruition in this podcast.
Yes.
Yeah.
So management denies that this ever happened, right? But there was investigation to this because guess what happened? The pilots and the stewardesses sue because they're tired of, they want to talk about this stuff. They don't want to be put, on psychiatric leave if they saw something unusual and they have to report it, right? That's part of the code.
Yeah.
And so, this is a thing. And the FAA does an investigation into this. And the FAA actually makes two recommendations from this. Now, they never say there was a ghost. They never say there's any reported hauntings. But they do make two recommendations. One, no plane is ever allowed to replace their logs. Now, Eastern is not ever convicted of replacing any logs. But why would you make that rule suddenly if it hadn't happened?
Yeah.
And then secondly, no one is allowed to be put on administrative leave for psychiatric evaluation for reporting a ghost. That's official FAA documentation. So the Federal Aviation Authority, something good came out of this.
I mean, if we've learned anything from this, it's that, hey, maybe don't bring haunted stuff into a place you're going to be. And like, I don't know, maybe some people listening, maybe some people recording could learn a thing or two, perhaps, from this lesson. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe that's just
not,
me.
That's not very subtle.
I don't have any parts from an L-1011.
Oh, right. I'm sorry. Right. I forgot about all the other haunted shit you have that's not plane parts.
I do have a question, though. I have a question. So, first of all, I have several questions. I'm going to go down my myriad of questions. I have not gotten to use the word myriad recently, so I appreciate the ability to do so. It's a good word. First of all of these, the quantity of recorded sightings and stuff would lead me to believe that this isn't the parts of the plane that got pushed out everywhere. I feel like this is something different because yes, they could use those parts, but there'd be a finite number of them versus the infinite number of sightings that they're seeing. More like these ghosts felt, I don't know, some degree of guilt or something for their part that they played in the deaths of the passengers. Mm-hmm. So that is my first thing. Second thing is, what about where this crashed? Are there ghost stories from there? Because that's a...
Now the area near there, it is swamp, right? You can't just drive out to that site and go see it. I've got more sighting reports because as I was researching this for Creepy Florida, I got a lot of stuff. And we actually went out there on an airboat from one of the local airboat tours, from Tiger Tails Airboat Tours. So thanks so much for taking us out there. There is, most famously, this got made into a book by that author, Fuller. And he, of course, may have exaggerated it a little bit for author's purposes. And now
we have no idea what that's like.
Yeah, exactly. never. One point they said that he said that they started pulling all the parts that had been recycled. And there was a report that engineers were pulling all the parts and replacing them with brand new ones. And that's what stopped the hauntings. And then now this all comes from the fact that the vice president of Eastern Airlines supposedly was beginning a conversation with an officer in first class on one of his own flights. And he thought he was talking to the captain of the flight. But then the captain came on and he turned to look at the guy next to him, and the guy next to him disappeared. So now if a vice president has seen this, I've got to fix this. So now the book Flight 401, Ghost of Flight 401 came out, and that also immediately got made into a made for television movie, The Ghost of Flight 401, starring the great late Ernest Borgnine. And they basically combined it all into Repo being the only ghost. They cut all the other ghost stories.
You know, this is what I hate about literary stuff to TV. You hear me say it all the time. You don't cut out the other ghosts, man. There's only three of them. You can make that shit work.
Yeah.
And so, can we get our hands on this movie? Does it still exist?
Oh, yeah, it still exists. You can watch it on YouTube, I believe. I know you can buy the book. The book is hard to get now, so it is a little pricey for collectors. But it's not terrible. It's like in the $20 range for a paperback.
So I'm thinking that we're going to have to say for our travels that you should find this book and watch the movie from the comfort of your own home.
Well, there is, the crash site does have active ghostly phenomena. It is investigated frequently in the right time of year. I will say, do not go in July or August.
He says this episode airs in July.
Exactly. But, you know, people hear, you know, the lesser known ghosts are people hearing disembodied screams, strange temperature spikes, and strange temperature drops, which is definitely not something normally happens in the Everglades. A lot of shadow figures in there, sometimes faces of the drowned seem to float up and vanish at the site. Now, May 1996.
So a couple of years later.
Well, yeah, just a little bit, 24 years later. Just a few hundred yards away from Flight 401, ValueJet Flight 592 crashes into the marsh, killing all 110 passengers and crew on board that one.
Oh my goodness.
And now that, a few miles south of that, you're on the old Alligator Alley. They put up a marker and a memorial for the flight 592. There is no marker for flight 401. So many visitors use the structure for the flight 592 marker as also for flight 401. And that's where we went to the remembrance special for the 50th anniversary. And so that's two horrific crashes less than 100 yards from each other in the Florida Everglades.
Well, who put up the marker and who didn't put up the other marker?
It was the state put up the initial marker.
Okay, state of Florida, get your shit together and get the other marker up. That can't cost more than a grand.
Up. Yep.
Ah, yes, Florida, a state known for getting its shit together.
Yeah,
it's us.
We're
accurate.
It's not like we have markers for absolutely everything else. You know,
yeah. I mean, I live really close to that, and I don't love that.
You're not that close to it. It's
I'm close enough.
Yeah, you're
way closer than I am, Callie.
Yeah. I don't like the proximity.
But, yeah, so when you're flying into Miami Airport, just, you know, make sure you keep your tray tables up and your seat back in the full upright position.
Or just change it to an Orlando flight, like...
Or land anywhere else. No, yeah, we shouldn't say that because honestly, I mean, yes, in general, when there is a flight crash, there usually is not survivors, but it is safer statistically to travel in a plane than it is on a lot of other modes of transportation.
True that. So, yeah, and it is part of the travels. You know, that's the whole point is get down there. But I do highly recommend you drive Old Alligator Alley sometime. You can go to Dave Sheely's Skunk Ape headquarters down there. See Goldie, the world's second largest snake in captivity that might be the longest now, but we haven't had it measured again in a while. And that was where one of the world's most famous skunk ape sightings ever happened. And so
if you're going to travel, choose the months of December, January, and February.
Yes.
Any of
highly recommend those months
are highly respectable months to be traveling in Florida. And you can always go get an airboat tour and talk to local paranormal experts down there if you want to go out to where the crash sightings are. Or, like me, you can get some popcorn, a glass of wine, maybe some ice cream, and watch Ernest Borgnine on Flight 401. And maybe, even better, read the book to hear the stories from Flight 401.
Or you can pick up Creepy Florida. Which has that amongst many other stories in it. So,
and can be your spooky guide to traveling around Florida.
Yep. And with that, folks, I just got to say, you know, we've traveled a lot of places and been to a lot of crazy things. Airboat rides in Florida are fantastic. So, you know, there's a reason everybody pays to do them because do it once at least.
I agree. I concur. And with that, I believe we have neared or at the end of our story. Are we, Mark?
I think so. That's all the ghost stories. Now there's other strange flights and occurrences. The Everglades are a mysterious place, and we will revisit them in the future. And thank you all so much for tuning in. Please like, share, and subscribe, and tell your friends. And hey, we made for July, we made
top
10 on Paranormality Mag's top 10 paranormal podcasts.
Which we love, and we love you listeners who are voting for us, but we made number 9. We can do better than that. We're way better than number 9.
Oh, hey, we broke the list. I'm happy that we're climbing the
chart. I know. You're happy we broke the list. I am demanding more.
I am too. Want
more. Oh. You're listening. Take a jaunt over to Paranormality Magazine and vote for us, because it is pretty awesome to be recognized. And we love you, listeners. Do not forget to send us listener tales. Have you ever had a ghostly experience on a flight? I'm just going to say, if I'm going to have a haunted flight, I want the haunted flight where they're looking out and protecting the flight like these ghosts were.
Oh, yeah.
They can join any flight I'm on anytime. I've seen a lot of, what is it, Twilight Zone? There are certain ghosts I don't need on my plane, please and thank you.
There's something on the wing.
Oh my god.
No,
speaking of that, did you know that they're going to have William Shatner is going to be at a Wrath of Khan screening in Florida, and you can buy tickets to it?
I love that. That's cool.
Have one of his last tours. I'm like, oh man, and I'm traveling that week, so but
Mark, send us off before we get totally sidetracked.
Destiny, play us out of here, and we'll see you on the other side.